Welcome to an invitation to sisterhood. We want you to join us on a journey as we discuss everyday issues affecting our lives. Women in the Bible and of Christian history continue to have an impact on the world even years after their deaths. We can learn so much from them. They are sisters of inspiration. And we're all sisters, sisters in Christ. We're talking about a vocation in the religious order, specifically Dominican Sisters of Mary, Mother of the Eucharist, a young and quickly growing community. The Dominican Sisters of Mary, Mother of the Eucharist, is a Roman Catholic community of religious women based in Ann Arbor, Michigan. This community was founded in the Dominican tradition to spread the witness of religious life in accord with St. John Paul II's vision for a new evangelization. Their teachings, educational tools, and materials extend throughout the United States, including locally in the Lansing Diocese and in the Detroit Archdiocese. They've experienced phenomenal growth and media appearances on Oprah, CBS This Morning, Fox and Friends, and the American Bible Challenge, one of my favorites. And on the show today is Sister Joseph Andrew, who will share with us their story about evangelizing the faith through the media. I'm with my co-hosts today, May Saman and Ikhlas Bashi. And ladies, I'm so excited about this show. I can't wait to talk to Sister. Our woman of inspiration is Mary Magdalene. And Ikhlas, I know you're going to share with us why we chose Mary Magdalene.
Yes, we chose her because she's fitting for our topic, I think, especially because when we're talking about evangelizing through the media, what we're doing is trying to spread Jesus's love and mercy throughout all four corners of the earth. And she's a great example because theologians believe that she's the same woman who, when the people in the town wanted to stone her, Jesus said, "Whichever of you is without sin, cast the first stone." And of course, everyone walked away. That's a powerful story of Jesus's mercy. And regardless of what her brokenness is and what our brokenness is, Jesus' mercy is just abundant. It's infinite. And then the example of her, washing Jesus' feet with the oil and wiping it with her hair, mm-hmm. That is a symbol of beauty, right? Mm-hmm. And it's a symbol of beauty that we rarely see in secular media anymore, and which really needs to be brought to the forefront. And I think the sisters that we're going to be featuring today, I believe it's the same thing, that they're, it's through their beauty, it's the world seeing Christ in them that makes the world attracted to them.
Mm-hmm. And it's the reason Oprah had them back on twice.
Yes.
It's in what amazed me about these women, that having a PR background and being a reporter, I know how difficult it is to get on an Oprah show,
sure.
and to get on Fox, and to get on CBS in the morning. It is not easy.
Yes.
And to have these women on Oprah twice, and I love the fact that they gave her a rosary that they made.
Yes.
They are evangelizing with such joy, with such faith in who they are and what they represent, which is Jesus Christ.
Yes.
And the fact that they use that platform to evangelize the faith, I think, is amazing. What do you think that says to the secular world? Because Oprah is the most watched show at the time she was on in the world.
Yeah.
I think for me as a Catholic, a cradle Catholic, when I see a nun, I'm always so excited. I know what they stand for. I'm aware of, the orders and the sacrifice that they give, just because, I am a cradle Catholic. So, however, I think the world that is not aware of who Jesus is or what the habit stands for, I think nonetheless they are still very attracted. Mm-hmm. Even the fact that they look at them, that in itself makes them wonder, mm-hmm. and hopefully will attract them to the point of wanting to find out, what is that all about?
Mm-hmm.
To have someone wearing a habit that is so simple, that speaks simplicity, and it speaks, for me personally, I think it speaks completely giving of self and leaving the world behind,
mm-hmm.
But giving yourself to the world and serving. So I think that for others, I think it definitely can plant a seed of curiosity, of wanting to know, and I think that's a start, especially for those who may not have grown up Catholic or who may not have grown up in a religious home. Mm-hmm. So I think, you know, they are walking testaments mm-hmm. of just sacrifice and love and self-giving.
Do you think it gives us more courage, your class, from your background as a therapist, to evangelize when you see them do that? If you could see the nuns go on Oprah, when I saw that, I thought, wow, they have such faith and such confidence to go on Oprah, which you sometimes could be judged by going on a national television show preaching about Catholicism.
Of course.
You know, or CBS or Fox, yeah. too, Fox and Friends. Do you think that gives courage to others
Absolutely.
To do the same?
Absolutely. As you were talking a few minutes ago and how they got on the Oprah show not only once but twice, I mean, that's evident of the power of the Holy Spirit working in the world. And you know, God is not dead, right? He's alive and well and living and breathing, and they're a testimony to that. And it's that Holy Spirit in them, you know, that gives that courage to speak the truth in love and in mercy and in charity, right? And so I do think that on a human level, right, we do need that courage, because mm-hmm. whether you're insecure, you know, people have faith. There's people that have faith, but they may not have that courage to speak that faith and to be, you know, a living witness. So it definitely takes courage, and I think that their example is really a beautiful one. And the other reason that, you know, I think the world is attracted to them and Oprah is, you kind of touched on it, May, is that, you know, their simplicity and their love and their witness through their bodies, right? The theology mm-hmm. of the body, how you see them walking and working in the world, that they have left the world behind, right? Being in the world, but not of the world. And there's just so much to unpack with that through their witness, mm-hmm. right? They just can give us so much as far as following their example. Mm-hmm.
And St. Dominic talked about how Mary encouraged people to pray the rosary, and the sisters
yes.
gave Oprah a rosary
yes.
That they made. And I think that's another way to evangelize, even if she didn't know what to do with it.
Yes.
And we're going to talk to Sister about that.
Yes.
Did she explain to her how to pray the rosary or
yes.
what you're supposed to do with it?
Yes.
Because even some Catholics don't even know how to play the rosary.
True.
So I think that's another way to simply evangelize, by giving Absolutely. Somebody something, you know?
I think it was the most beautiful gift that they could have given her, especially given what St. Dominic said about the Blessed Mother, that mm-hmm. she would save the world through the rosary mm-hmm. and the scapular. And Mary wants us all to consecrate ourselves to her heart. And what a beautiful symbol of beauty and faith and representation of the Blessed Mother. That was just the perfect gift that they could have given her.
And I think even more significant, honestly, the giver has a lot to do with how you value the gift.
Yes. Mm.
So I think the fact that, you know, they came on this show and really just who displayed their love and their authenticity of their identity, mm-hmm. you know, which is so visible in mm. how they look. Mm. You know, and again, like I said, I think people are curious when they see someone dressed in a habit.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the fact that obviously spoke a lot, and obviously having them come back twice, what was coming out of their mouths was even more attractive, and people wanted to hear more. And so I think, you know, the gift became much more meaningful mm-hmm. and much more significant because you wonder, you know, when someone who portrays that beauty, as you spoke of, gives you something, you look at it differently. You think about it differently mm-hmm. and you receive it differently because of the giver himself mm-hmm. or herself.
Yes.
So I think that, you know, again, I think it's just their testimony. And so therefore, what they give, whether in words or in actual physical, you know, gifts,
yes.
material as in a rosary,
yeah.
comes through to who they are and who God created them to be and what they represent. It all speaks mm-hmm. to that.
And I think it's so wonderful that the sisters are using the media to mm-hmm. evangelize the faith, as Pope John Paul II, St. Paul John Paul II has called yeah. us to this new evangelization, which was the foundation of ECRC, the yes. Eastern Catholic Re-Evangelization yeah. Center, which our production company's out of, and to use that and encourage other people to do the same. And now the Pope has a Twitter page, you mm-hmm. know, the Pope is on Twitter and on Facebook, yeah. And the Vatican has a page. And I think it's so wonderful to show to reach out to the youth through the medium that they're using, yes. which is social media, mm-hmm. and to evangelize that way, and how that encouraged the rest of us to do the same. Yes. And I think the sisters definitely have a calling and are showing people examples of how to use the media to bring others to Christ.
Mm-hmm. It's so important to be able to communicate with others. Sometimes, you know, we view the media or the social media, it does have so many disadvantages, mm-hmm. but there sure. are so many other advantages. And it makes me wonder, sometimes I've thought about, you know, the apostles were walking everywhere to yeah. all, yes. you know, to yeah. evangelize. Yes. And I wonder if they lived in today's world.
Would they use social
would
media?
Would they be using social media?
Probably.
And you know what? Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Our youth, I mean, who's our future? Our youth. And so I think it's so awesome that they use the social media, whether it's Facebook or Twitter, and how they reach people and speak to them. And be present to them in a way without really being physically present to them. Mm-hmm. So I'm excited to hear what it is that they, I mean, I know what they post, but I want them to tell us about that.
Yes.
And the responses that they get uh-huh. and the, you know, the effects that they've had on others and yes. the fruits that they've noticed. So mm-hmm. I'm excited to hear about that.
Well, it was interesting when the Pope was here, one of the news reports was saying that he's more followed than most leaders in the world. Mm-hmm. There's more followers on the Pope's Twitter page than the President of the United States.
That is so awesome.
Isn't that cool?
And again, that goes back to St. John Paul II, who said that the nature of truth is that it longs to reveal itself. Right? Mm-hmm. And so his nature and their nature is revealing that truth to the world. And the world is very hungry. Mm-hmm. The world is thirsty for the truth.
And we're going to find out more. I bet you the sisters know how thirsty and hungry they are.
Yes.
Because they've been out talking to people. And I can't wait. We're going to take a break and we're going to come back and we're going to talk to Sister Joseph Andrew from the Dominican Sisters right here in our own backyard, because right here in Detroit area, and they're yes. in Ann Arbor. And we're going to come back and talk with her. Stay with us, everyone. Welcome back. With us is Sister Joseph Andrew from the Dominican Sisters of Mary, Mother of the Eucharist, an order out of Ann Arbor, Michigan. And Sister, we're so excited to have you on the show. Thanks so much for being here with us.
And thank you so very much. This is a real privilege for us and an honor. And we want to thank you for what you do for the church. This is beautiful. Thank you.
Thank you. And it's our pleasure. And we're really excited about this conversation. And as we were talking about in the last segment, is that we're so impressed that this new order, you're fairly new, you're not that uh-huh. old of an order, mm-hmm. and you've accomplished so much in evangelizing the faith on the national platform, having been on Oprah and Fox and Friends and CBS and on the Bible Challenge. And how did that come about? How did you end up on that national stage?
Well, you know, God gets what he wants, and I think I think he gives us all these wonderful opportunities, and we just have to have the faith to walk on water for him, you mm-hmm. know? And so he opens those doors. I think the world is starving for God. Mm-hmm. There is such a holy curiosity. Yes. I think there's such a desire for him to come and fill every heart, that someone who God has blessed that has the ability to invite the sisters to share this message, I think they want it as much as the people who will listen to it do. You know, mm-hmm. I think God is using that void in the heart that he wants to come into, and people are responding to it. And so we received all these invitations, and whenever it's at all possible, even if we have to change our schedules or anything, we try to say yes, because as true Dominicans, we are teachers and preachers through the whole world. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And why use the media? Do you think that is the most powerful way you use social and traditional media?
In a nutshell, as you all certainly know, the media gets the word out to the homes, to the people in their comfort of their own situation where their hearts can open. They don't have to get dressed up and go out and go searching for. Mm-hmm. They just have to turn it on, and God is speaking through people who so desire Him to use them for the good, the true, the beautiful, for the message of His heart, really, which so wants to come to all of us. And I just think the media is where it's at today, you know. Mm-hmm. We can teach all day long, and we certainly do that. Our sisters are teaching in over 20 different schools now, from kindergarten through high school and also in university. Mm-hmm. And that's beautiful, and that's our primary apostolate. And when we founded our community in 1997, we knew that the primary apostolate as Dominicans is preaching and teaching. And we will do this, you know, first off, of course, in our schools. But then beyond that, we want to preach and teach to the world wherever God wishes to send us. And these opportunities have come. We don't really go out and ask for them. But again, I think that's part of a world that's very spiritually starving. And so it's asking to be fed. And we are more than happy as spiritual mothers to go feed the children. So we go wherever these opportunities come, and we have been very, very blessed, and it thrills us, you know, to be able to spread the word of God on the airways, just as you all are doing so beautifully. Mm-hmm. I mean, it really is.
Seems like it brings you a lot of joy, sister.
Immensely so. Yes. And I think you said the word that's beautiful, because joy is a fruit of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
And it's far deeper than happiness, because
yes,
only God can give that.
Yes.
And with that, I always think there's an abiding peace. And I think that's very attractive. Like,
yes,
I want that peace. I want that, yes, exuberant joy,
yes,
you know, and
yes,
that's very much what God does. And the world's just eating it up,
yes,
you know. Yeah.
How has the exposure of being on all this social media impacted your order in particular?
You know, I have a funny story about that, May. Very interestingly, when we were going on Oprah, mm-hmm, she warned us. Now, it's been known that when you come on my program, we can, you know, crash your website because so many people watch this and will be responding.
Yes.
Well, in God's providence, we had just begun, or we were actually in the middle of working to up the power of our website, to renew it and to put a fresh face on and to make it more powerful. So we hit the button, so to speak, to begin that about 1 hour before the first Oprah program was shown.
Wow. Oh my goodness.
And I guarantee you, the response,
wow,
would have annihilated our,
wow,
first one.
Wow.
We were barely able to keep up with by the second one, which was this new updated version. And then Oprah
also. Talk about
God's
timing.
The timing was just,
yes,
the Holy Spirit,
yes,
again. And then the Oprah also sent us many of her own emails that she got. She said, we're being flooded with them, so tell me when and I will send you, you know, many that we are receiving.
Wow.
So that you see how,
praise God,
really,
thank
ultimately
you, Jesus,
the world. And it continued because Oprah's program goes went
worldwide,
around the world.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So we would get these sometimes in languages I hadn't a clue what the language,
wow,
was, but it would come, and we would pray. We pray for everybody that, you know, for their own openness to God, and that, you know, God was able to use us to speak His words. So, yeah, I mean, she was right. So the awareness, I think, of Christ and His love. And I think ultimately what really got to Oprah was several things. And I think through her to the mass people who follow her, watch her, is the fact that we have so many sisters, and they are so young, and they are so intelligent, and they are so joyful, mm-hmm, and they can speak, you know, a language of the heart in their speaking of the language of truth.
Yes.
You know, and I think you put those two together, and there could hardly be someone of goodwill, certainly,
yes,
that would say, I disagree.
Yes.
You kind of can't.
Right. Yes.
Here's,
yeah,
the proof.
Yes.
And here's these young women that are flinging their life at Christ,
yes,
and doing so with such immense joy and that abiding peace.
Yes.
And I think that really also spoke very strongly to Oprah, which is why we ended up being, at the end of the season, we ended up being third in her lineup of the most watched programs, which surprised her. We go, well, whatever that means, great. And she kept, you know, trying to, I think, get a reaction. And we're like, well, you know, God's involved, so we're not too surprised. But, you know, and then she said, well, no, what I'm trying to say is you have to be on again because my public really liked you, and so did I, and I want you on again. Mm-hmm. And so that's how the second program came to be.
And that's not surprising. I remember when I first saw you, the enthusiasm and the love of life and the joy that you portrayed was so contagious, especially the young nuns. And I think that was probably the most attractive, because yes, of course, as I you know, like I said, I love seeing a nun in a habit, and when I do see a nun in a habit, it doesn't matter where I am, whether I'm standing in line at a Costco or I'm at a parking lot, I always make the time to go up to them and thank them for wearing that habit, because it speaks volumes without a word. But honestly, I think it is the young nuns that you have, they're so youthful. You know, they are so young. They are young in age, and it's amazing that they've given up the world and given themselves to this simplicity that the world does not, the most people of the world do not understand and want to know. So after you were exposed to all that social media, have your numbers increased?
And actually, if so, they truly have, and so have the invitations. So that's how we got to be known. And Jeff Foxworthy would invite us, you know, to be on the Bible Challenge, and all these things came. As I said, we didn't ask for any of them. We don't even know some of these programs are out there hardly, because we really don't watch it as much. But we are on so many different things, because I think really God used Oprah to open the doors to social media a vast world that probably doesn't know we exist and certainly would not understand, like, why we do this or what the commitment means. You know, I know that Oprah just grilled the sisters over and over on our three vows of poverty, chastity, and obedience. Yeah. And their answers just had her, I can remember at one point, she leaned back in her chair and she said, I get it. And the sister that was speaking said,
got the Holy Spirit right
exactly. there. And the sister that was speaking tried to say, well, in other words, and she goes, no, I mean it. I get it.
Wow.
And you could see a change in her from that moment on. The questions became deep. They didn't become like, well, you know, isn't this a bit on the crazy side? Don't you have to kind of admit that chastity in today's world is a bit ridiculous or poverty? Come on, do you really, or obedience? She's like, I get it. And then it's like, this is challenging herself personally. This is challenging my viewers. This is beautiful. This is elevating us all. You know, we would say, of course, to God. And of course, you're going to respond, because it is of God who made you and loves you and is calling you in this very instant. You know, so there was such a change. And from then on, the questions became more fun, because until then, we were just trying to get her to understand. She representing the world that would never begin to open up to these things, you know, because it's not their world. But it happened.
And it shows you how great God is. I mean, to use the most powerful television show in the world, because she had the most powerful television show, and then the most influential people in the world, because she was and probably still is, to evangelize through you. I mean, it really, if you think about it, he used the most, I mean, she was rated as one of the top, like, five most powerful people in the world at one point. And she knows the power of her platform very well. She knows it. And so to use that to evangelize, you know how great God is. It's like, you almost have to chuckle with him and say, ha ha, I get what you said. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
You
know,
because it's so amazing, because she's not a show that you would typically, I mean, I know some Catholics who have debated, who have been invited to her show, have debated whether they should go on her show because of other topics she's covered. But why not use that amazing platform to evangelize the faith? And I think it's wonderful. What was her reaction to you or to the sisters when you gave her the rosary?
Yes.
Oh, that was really beautiful. So, interestingly, at the end of each of her programs, she would always thank the, you know, the people that she had on her program, and then they would leave, and she would walk among the audience, you know, so that the people that were there could maybe have the gift of meeting her, because she really, it is a gift, there's no doubt, as it is to meet anyone, but I'm just saying, you know. But this time, the sister said, "Oprah, we have something that we made for you." And she said, "You made something for me?" You know, I'm sure that's probably not a common thing. And they said, "Yes," and they handed her the rosary, and she looked at it, and she saw the crucifix, and she said, "This is beautiful." And then the sister said, "And here's a card. It's called the rosary." And the card tells you how to pray the rosary. Well, see, she was so overwhelmed, she turned to one of her helpers in the studio and said, "Explain to everybody, I'm not going to be out walking around. I'm talking to the sisters." And she ducked to the back with the sisters and continued the conversation and asked about it. Then, as her 25 years was ending, you know, months later, and she only had, I believe it was like the last, maybe I'm going to say three programs, she had that rosary in her hand. And I remember the very last one, I think it was, she was thanking everyone for supporting her in her 25 years and that she loved them and her gratitude. And she said, "But as deep as my gratitude is to each of you, it was God," and she had, there was that crucifix in her hand, there was that rosary, was God who made it all possible.
And this was months later, sister?
This was the very, I think, the last of her 25. And she explained it on another one that this is in her room, and it's where she keeps her very most prized possessions. And she has the rosary there. And we're like, "Well, that's beautiful. Now use it, you know." But in any case, and we have to say that we really respect her so highly because she, I always say she'd be a great Dominican because she's she's not only does she have the airwaves that's teaching and preaching throughout the world, but she has a passion for truth.
Yes.
And she will say, and you will know when she'll be good. Okay, and this is where, you know, on occasion it would be kind of interesting. She might not agree with someone, but if they're passionate about it and it means a great deal to them, she will respect that. But with our message, it came down to, "You've educated me. You've helped me see more. And I love it and I want it in the way it can be in her own personal life." And she really, as I said, at that moment, it was like she just changed. It was, "Tell me more. I am now the student sitting here wanting to know more." I always think of St. John Paul the Great's phrase, sitting at the school of Mary.
Yes.
You know, and learning the truths of her son.
Yes.
You know, and that's our spiritual motherhood as religious sisters in the world today. So in a way, that reversal, I think, kind of became apparent. And Oprah is very honest. I love her because she goes after what she believes in with a passion, and I love that. And I think she really did see more into, you know, hopefully her own soul and her own mission, and I think her own life. And I think she was ready for the challenge.
I think, you know, the fact that rosary, honestly, that it meant so much to her was because of the love and the truth of God that you relate to her. That was what was powerful, because if someone had just given her a rosary, she wasn't going to take it on to her last show and hold it.
Of course.
It's because of what of the testimony that you lived, and she was able to see it just as other viewers saw it. And so that brings me to my next question. So so obviously when someone meets you or when someone sees you, you know, it's you are a testimony, you know, just by your habit.
Yes.
But then how are you able to communicate that through the social media when we're not hearing you and when we're not necessarily seeing you in person? Because I know when I post something on you know, on Facebook, you know, of religious content, I don't know how much of an effect it can have But do you have any, how do you do that in order to reach others? I mean, I know people know of you, but how do you do it?
Let me give this. That's a beautiful question. Okay, one thing, that this just happened yesterday, and we have a Facebook, and it's like 3.5 years old now. And we have over 682,000 followers, I guess you would say. I don't even understand exactly how
friends,
it works.
Friends.
Yes.
Okay. That's who we
have. Facebook is friends. Yes. Followers.
It's working. And someone posted yesterday, and I don't usually even have the time to read all of them. I just say for everybody who's communicating with us, you know, that this will be sent to, that the hearts will be open as God wishes to. Anyway. But this one just came. And I don't even exactly remember why I read it, but it said the most joy-filled Facebook out there in social media. Thank you, sisters, for always raising us up to God.
I love it.
And I just thought that pretty much says why we do the social media, to bring people where they want to go and where Christ is calling them. Yes. So we're the instruments, we're the intermediaries, so to speak. But it's all, as you all have all said so beautifully, it's all the work of God.
It is.
He's calling them into His own heart, which is always open, and those arms are always saying, come to me and I will lighten your load and I will give you refreshment and I will love you in a way you, no one else is capable, but through their love, you will see a glimmer of mine. His desire is so intense and constant, and we want God. You know, we want God, and so through all these little things, we're able to, by His goodness, reach a world that wants what we have, and we give our lives to give it back to everyone. You know, and as you mentioned, which is true, when someone sees us, and I do a lot of traveling as the vocation director for our community, so, and really all the foundresses were always on the road someplace. Anyway, but they see this habit, and usually there's an instant smile. You know, sometimes there's not, and then those I go seek out. You know, like, oh, do you have a prayer intention? Would you like, you know, would you do whatever you can, even in your own person? And I remember many years ago reading that St. John Paul the Great was meeting with a group of sisters, and for whatever reason, I don't know the community, but whether or not they were going to retain the habit was going to be in their chapter meetings, their official meetings. And so since that question came up, the Holy Father looked at them very directly, and this is the phrase he used, and I love it. Don't take Christ off the street. Meaning when people see your habit, immediately, they don't know the person inside. I might not ever be able to meet them until heaven.
But
they see a reminder of God.
What
a reflection
statement.
Of the Blessed Mother. A warmth and an energy and a dynamism and a hope that is still there and still calling people to become the fullness of all God created us to be. So I think
so
it raises up
to
the great virtue of hope.
And you know, sister, I have to kind of chime in here, because when you were still talking a few moments ago about Oprah and your experience on the show and her experience on the show, and the response of the public. So, you know, I have a background in psychology, and I'm a writer too, but I think about the masses. And I think about our present day, and I think about, and my heart is torn, and I pray for all these intentions. So all the people that are just ridden with anxiety, all the rise in depression in the society, especially in the United States, the rise in suicide, and especially among young people, and the rise in pornography, all these ills that are, that really, and as we were saying earlier, that Satan has God's people bound by. And I think the attraction of you and your order, and the responses from the public with your social media and with being on Oprah, is that longing to fill that space that all of us have. It's that dark hole, right? The black hole that St. Augustine said, that we're going to be restless until we're filled with Him. And so the two words that kept going back to me as you were speaking is joy and peace. So when you look at all those ills, that's what people are missing, mm-hmm. is the joy and the peace that mm-hmm. comes from Christ. But they're filling it with all these other things. Mm-hmm. And so no wonder people are attracted to you.
You know, Nicholas, you said it so beautifully. At one point, our Facebook, I don't know if it crashes or what it does. Again, I run it, but I really don't know exactly what I'm doing. But anyway, it wasn't working correctly.
Yes.
And oh, yeah, an so overlord. It had to kind of close for maybe it was 3 or 4 days. Well, when it got
back
fixed
up,
yeah. and back up and running again, there were more comments about, where did you go? Don't ever do that to us again.
Wow.
Do you know how we look forward to the gospel message and your little wow. inspirations every single morning? Mm-hmm. It wasn't the same. You can't do this to us. Yeah. So it's kind of exactly what you were saying of yeah. people really want that. And when they find a place that they can do it.
Yes.
And again, why would we not?
Yes.
I mean, I think... Does it take faith to a certain extent? Yes, but duh.
Yeah.
I mean, are we living this, and don't we take Him at His yes, word? And yes. isn't it always His message
yes.
through the instruments of us?
Yes.
Right. All we have to do is have the open heart, and it's His voice, His message coming through.
Yeah.
And it's very true also that you brought out, interestingly, St. Mary Magdalene is patroness of the Dominican Order.
Oh.
I didn't think you probably knew that.
Wow. We didn't.
And I was just
that's
so
the work of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, I was just cheering you on because she was the first woman to preach and teach He is risen.
Yes.
Wow. And on that miracle, yes. all our faith rest.
Yes. Wow.
He is risen.
Praise
and it
God.
Took a woman wow. with a big mouth and an enthusiasm wow. and a dynamism to get out there and not care what anybody thought of her
yes.
because the important thing was they knew He is risen.
Yes.
And I just love St. Mary Magdalene.
That is so
and
perfect.
I love the fact that she's patroness of the Dominican Order. I also say she's,
wow.
you know, she converted from her sins, so
yes.
that's another good reason for
yes.
us all to love her. But she got out there and she spoke and she didn't care what others thought
wow.
because she was given by her own openness of heart
yes.
and her own faith
yes.
a knowledge the world did not know. And she was
yes.
able to go out and preach and teach. And I could just see the Blessed Mother in the background going, you go, you go.
I love it.
I know it, but you do too.
Yes.
So
yes.
my son knew exactly who to put it in the heart. To come mm-hmm. looking for Him.
And she represents the love of Christ because she was a sinner. And I think she's such an example to people who feel they can't change their ways.
Yes.
That God loves you no matter what. He
yes.
wants you to come back. No matter how dark of a place you went to in your life, He wants
yes.
you to come back to the light.
Yes.
It goes back to your whole point of being imprisoned by the ills of the world that Satan has put
yeah.
on us. Some people feel that they're such guilt.
Hopelessness
and guilt.
Helplessness.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
yeah. Yes.
And a level of guilt that they feel like they're not worthy.
Well, you know, it's interesting mm. because as I was driving in this morning thinking about St. Mary Magdalene, I thought, well, I know it wasn't my thought, it was the Holy Spirit. I thought it was Jesus's mercy that was poured forth on her. And then what did Jesus get in return was her love.
Mm-hmm.
Was her love. So that's what the world needs. They're in dire need of Jesus's mercy.
Mm-hmm.
And it's in scripture, isn't it, sister, that there's no sin that is greater or beyond God's mercy,
exactly.
mercy
mm-hmm.
and grace,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
So people need to know that there's hope,
mm-hmm.
regardless of where you've been and what you've done. And that goes back to the other thing that your order represents, is that beautiful feminine genius,
yes.
right?
Yes.
Right,
yes.
that's represented to us in the
yes.
model of Mary, our mother. Mm-hmm. And that tells us, no matter who you are, what you've done, you have dignity.
Mm-hmm.
You have worth.
Mm-hmm.
You have value.
Mm-hmm.
And you have gifts. And God wants to use you. And
especially in a world of judgment.
Yes.
And to use Mary Magdalene, who was being judged by the world at the time, and for Jesus to say, you're not here yes. on this earth to judge her.
Yes.
And I think that there's such so many messages in just her as an alone yes. and that yeah. example of her.
There are. And you know what's Absolutely. Powerful? And sister, correct me if I'm wrong, but with my experience, you talked about judgment. So that's condemnation, right? Mm-hmm. And I think there's definitely that condemnation, fear of it from others. But I think that Satan, who has no power here, thrives on the way he whispers in our ear that creates self-condemnation,
yes,
right? Mm. Which binds people and which prevents them from really moving forward in the direction of God and all that is truth.
You know, Nicholas, I think you said that beautifully, and Pope Francis would be applauding you if he were he sitting in our midst.
Thank you, Holy Spirit.
That is such a message that he really has, not only, as we know from Scripture, don't judge others lest you be judged,
yes.
but lest you be judged by yourself.
Yeah.
Because when we fall away from God, we get by ourselves and misery, you know,
yes.
it's Saint Ignatius, you know, founder of the Jesuits, who says Satan presents the temptation as beautiful, and you give yourself to it without adequate prayer and
discernment. Yes.
And then later you experience the evil interiorly that you have now produced also. You have been an agent of. Mm-hmm. And so it's the same thing with the good. You know, you might not feel like getting up and coming here and doing
yes.
this, but God uses those sacrifices and he redeems the world. And then you go back yes. home and you go, thank you, Jesus, that, you know, despite my headache or my
yes.
my long list of things to do, that I gave you first dibs. You know, mm-hmm. when we pray, when we give time to Christ, when you do this incredible program so that others can grow closer to Christ through this. And then you get away and you know that you're a bit of a co-redemptress with Christ. You're
Amen.
Very much walking, Amen. You women, very much walking in the footsteps of the Blessed Mother, who is faithful all the way through.
Yeah.
You know, the hope that she gives us. And the one who kept the faith on Holy Saturday,
yes.
who knew he would come back,
yes.
knew this too was part of the plan and he would
yes.
rise.
Yes. And you know, and I think talking about all the suffering that people endure and the self-condemnation and what they're really searching for, and it's hard sometimes in the world that we live in, even though we're aware of it as believers, to give it to others. And I think that's where I think your social media connection plays a role, because everyone is looking to be happy. Mm-hmm. Everyone is looking to be loved. And I think, you know, with all that you were talking about, Ikhlas, you know, all the suffering, all the searching, all the seeking, I think you, God, you know, has used your particularly your order to attract those people, even those who do not know the Lord, because of what you do post on your social media, even though they have not met you, mm-hmm. joyful things. Everyone wants to be happy and they want to know, how do you get that? I want to be like that.
Uh-huh.
You know, I want to be smiling. I want to be enjoying life the way that they are. What do they have?
Yes.
Yeah,
what are
a,
they
that's
doing
a very good
and what
point,
do
babe.
They have? And so, you know, I think as believers, we can recognize that, okay, we're searching for Christ. I think, you know, I think what separates your evangelization from maybe the common Catholic or the common Christian, like I know what I post on there. Sometimes I'll post very difficult things for people to want to hear,
uh-huh.
or
uh-huh.
some very things that might be I don't know,
controversial,
politically exactly.
incorrect,
right? And yes, so while it's important, yes. to post things like that, not people are not necessarily there even because of the suffering or what they're going through. They may not necessarily want to have to deal with that. Want to have more to deal with. You know, and they just want to be left alone so that they can have that peace, so that they can have a little bit of joy in their day. And I think that's where you come in. Your particular way of evangelizing through the social media is complete, like, joy of the world.
It is, and I'll tell you, I follow their Facebook. I like page, and every time I see a picture, I just smile. It's like, what are they doing now?
They're roller skating.
I love it.
They're going on field trips.
And I always have to chuckle. I was like, I love these women.
We just try to post little snippets into our life, as you said, to really to lift up the world that is suffering and to say, go for the gold and you too will know the joy, you know? But at the same time, you know, what you were saying with the challenge that you post on yours, we do that, you know, a great deal too through our teaching and through other, you know, through other situations that we're able to do that, because that too is very, very important. Because I think when we were referring to the suicides in young people, my take on that is we're not challenging young people, so they don't see a tomorrow that they need to give their entire today to get to, because it is so important and so valuable and so beautiful and so compelling. And so, but we don't, we kind of leave them through acedia, et cetera. And another quote that I was thinking of from another great Dominican, Saint Catherine of Siena.
I love her.
And she says, this is often quoted, but it's just so right on. And I think our community imbibes this. If you are what you should be, you will set the whole world on fire. And that's just so true. And why would you not want to be like that? So,
well, we're going to have to say amen and leave it on that. Because we have run out of time for this segment. And sister, thank you so much for being here and being such a joyful inspiration to us. And
can we have them back again?
How about to be continued instead of the end or amen?
We'll definitely have you back on. Not exactly Oprah, but we'll have you back on. God bless. Thank you so much. And stay with us, everyone.
Sister.
We're going to continue this conversation, of course, end our show with a sisterhood pledge. We'll be right back. And welcome back to Invitation to Sisterhood. We've been talking about the Dominican Sisters of Mary, Mother of the Eucharist, and what a wonderful guest sister was. I just loved having her on, and I think we've all said it, and sister said it a million times, really the theme was joy.
Yes.
And that's what they bring to the world. And did you feel their joy, her joy, when she was on the show?
It's still here. It's still lingering.
And they exuded joy. They just, it's very contagious.
Yeah.
It's hard not to, you know, become, you know, change your mood. If you're in a bad mood, you automatically have this, you know, good mood just because they're around. They're so joyous. They have this smile, this glow about them.
Yeah.
Of just who they are and of that authentic personhood, you know?
And that's evangelizing.
Yes.
Without even thinking you're evangelizing, just knowing the truth and walking into the room and your presence that is joyful evangelizes the faith, because people automatically want to know.
That's right.
How are you that way?
That's right, because it was St. Francis, I believe, who said, preach the gospel at all times, and if you need to, use words.
Exactly.
And they preach it by their presence in the world. And really, the fruits of the Holy Spirit within this order, and their power, I mean, it all just comes from the Holy Spirit, because as sister said, God wants to manifest himself to this world and to every single person. And it's just so clear that they're filled with the Holy Spirit, you know, who's the giver of all those gifts, joy, mercy, love, Mm-hmm. Right?
So. And for you to have thought of Mary Magdalene to be our woman of inspiration, yes. Not knowing.
That was divine providence.
It was
right?
divine providence. Yes. Was that not amazing?
Because our minds are feeble.
Yeah.
But see, the key is to surrender to the Holy Spirit. Because mm-hmm. as human beings, we want to be in control. And like Father Andrew from our St. Thomas Chaldean Church said to me recently, he said, you know, the question that you ask yourself to try to understand things in the world, he said, that's the gift of reason that God has given you. And it's important to ask questions. Mm-hmm. He said, but at the same time, it's that same gift that could get you in trouble. Meaning that it's that...
Are you doubting that?
It's that thing within us that's human that just wants to be in control.
Oh, yeah. Oh, of course.
That wants to try to understand everything. Well, why did this happen? So when you surrender yourself really to the Holy Spirit, and God's designs are so much more beautiful than ours. I mean, who would have thought, like you said, you know, Mary Magdalene turns out to be their
patroness.
That was
no coincidence.
Patroness.
That was not a coincidence.
As our other
How many saints did we email? People don't realize it.
Oh, my goodness.
We pick our woman of inspiration. We were really thinking about this. Yes. And how many women did we throw out there or saints we threw out there? Yes. And when you came up with this right before we recorded the show and said, I'm gonna talk about Mary Magdalene, and you didn't even have notes.
Yes. Yes.
Which is, it is divine providence. It really is. It's amazing. And I just, the joy that she exudes, I honestly wanted to know more. It's like, I want to go and read
and
more about
peace.
Yeah.
And the peace.
Yeah. I think honestly, when it comes to, you know, just the whole message of evangelizing, whether it's through social media or what have you, which is, you know, one of the topics that we had them here for. But I think ultimately, though, it's what truly becomes a tool of evangelization is realizing who you are, who your maker is, your purpose, your value, and your worth. Mm-hmm. And so when you believe in that, and you believe it, and you speak to people, and you know, you are joyful. You are joyous, regardless of what the world says. And I think the fact that this is what they post on their social media accounts. This is how they evangelize for those who maybe did not see the Oprah show. Although we hope everyone has seen them on there or heard of them. But that's not necessarily true. So I think ultimately, what is coming through is the way they're evangelizing is their authentic identity of who they are and who they were created by. And so that brings them the joy that they have.
Yes.
And that reveals the connection that they have and the realization of their worth and of their purpose. And that's what people see, because aren't we all searching for what we're here for, what we're supposed to be doing, mm-hmm. how we can be happy. Mm-hmm. And I think ultimately that is the tool that speaks the loudest. That the
authenticity, the knowing
who you are. And of course that goes back to God himself.
And it enables you to surrender more, which I believe it was surrendering that Mary Magdalene came to Eucharist. I mean, mm-hmm. she just gave it up to the Holy Spirit to speak through her. And that's how we came up with our woman of inspiration today.
Yes.
And of course, we always, you know, we ran out of time, ladies. We just, it goes by so fast. and we always end our show, of course, with our sisterhood pledge, which May is going to bring to all of us today on this show.
I pledge to always seek God and portray the person He has created me to be in all my communications, including through social media. I pledge to speak truth as opposed to being politically correct. I pledge to be more courageous in sharing Christ through social media.